But I don't know.
Cardi
awesome.
B, don't worry about it. Let's do the television show.
Let's
no,
do
that's
the
not
going to
be on the teleprompter.
Okay. No, it's not. No, not what you're talking about. Hey, there would be no big moves for the Cavs, they said. It would be tough to make a blockbuster deal, they said. You can't wear a high ponytail, they said. Well, guess what? Some people said that. The Cavs responded, and now the Cavs look a lot different than they did yesterday at this time. They sent out six players and a first-round pick, including Isaiah Thomas and Dwayne Wade. Coming back, Larry Nance Jr., Jordan Clarkson, George Hill, and Rodney Hood. And all we can wonder is, what does this mean for the future of LeBron and the Cleveland Cavaliers? General Manager Kobe Altman, who many said he was in over his head with all this, describes his thought process making these deals.
We were really worried that we were going to march. We were marching a slow death. We didn't want to be a part of that. I think we're going to get a rejuvenated LeBron James, and that's the key. He's the guy that is going to take us back to the promised land.
All right, so the biggest part of all this is the one thing they didn't want to give up was the
Brooklyn pick.
And they managed to do all this without giving up the Brooklyn pick. So, CC, I will start with you. You heard what Kobe said there. They were not going in a great direction, but they somehow turned it all around. How important were these trade deals for LeBron James and the Cavs?
Well, they were very important to critical, you know, for LeBron and his life in Cleveland. The first thing was that a little bit after 12, Nick, you and I were talking, and we got the first deal, Isaiah Thomas. But part of the first deal was that they had traded the first round pick, which also let you know that they were potentially going to make other moves, but they couldn't trade the Brooklyn pick. Once you trade that first rounder, as far as the NBA and what the rules are, you can't trade your other first round pick. So it really kind of let them, man, they're going to have the Brooklyn pick. Now, what other assets are they going to be able to add?
Right.
They added some younger players. They also added more money to their salary cap. So they won't be in the same situation that they were in before when LeBron left. They would have competent NBA players who had a couple years left on their deal. So they would have the option of LeBron, if this works, they would have the option to be able to keep LeBron next year. If it doesn't work, they still have the Brooklyn pick, and they still would have some flexibility, even though they would have some luxury tax.
A lot of luxury tax
implications from this deal. But it also showed you that the Cavs and their ownership, Kobe, the general manager, that they're trying to win.
Yeah.
And more importantly, they're trying to keep LeBron James in Cleveland. So they started off yesterday where LeBron James was definitely leaving Cleveland. And with the moves with the Los Angeles, now he's got two more teams that he can potentially go to. We talked about Houston, San Antonio as potential landing spots. The Lakers have also cleared enough room. They could sign LeBron and another max player. And as Nick always indicated, the chance of him staying in Cleveland, the probability went way, way up with all the moves.
Because we said that was predicated on whether they would win or not.
Listen, I reject the idea that LeBron was definitely leaving prior to the trade deadline. But it was certainly trending that way. So what does this mean for the Cavs? As far as the Eastern Conference playoffs go, I don't think it means much. They were going back to the finals, in my eyes, on the strength of LeBron James either way. But what it means to their ability to compete in those finals, it means the world. They would have been drawing nearly dead against Golden State.
And they had a great potential to not get to the finals, Nick. I mean, with the way they were playing basketball, we just can't assume that they were going to be able to fix this. Because, yes, LeBron has been the constant. But we had never seen the type of basketball around LeBron, especially into February, that could jeopardize his run at consistent finals.
Listen, I know everyone was worried about that but me, and that's a hypothetical now we'll never know.
That's not true, though, Nick. You were concerned, too.
I was concerned about their ability to compete in the championship round. I was not concerned about a Boston or Toronto or Milwaukee beating
them. Were you concerned about LeBron playing with potentially a second or third best player, Isaiah Thomas?
Well, I thought by the time the playoffs came around that Isaiah Thomas would, if he was playing the way he was that we had seen, he would be out of the rotation. Now he's off the team, so it doesn't matter. So we can stay in the here and now for what this means. This Cavs team just got exponentially better defensively by, forget who they added, by who they subtracted. Isaiah Thomas was the worst defensive player, according to advanced metrics, in 25 years in the NBA. Derrick Rose, that is addition by subtraction. You talk about Jay Crowder. That's addition by subtraction as far as mopey in the locker room. I told you guys a few weeks ago.
There were three players that had to go.
Had to go.
IT, Crowder, and Derrick Rose. They all had to go. And you could see in the celebration from two nights ago, Derrick Rose's celebration was totally different. IT's celebration was 100%. Totally different than the rest of the players.
So the team got better by just extracting those guys. I told you guys a few weeks ago, and there are some times that I'm speculating on things. There are some times I have some actual insight. The Cavs are a team I have reason to have actual insight about. The LeBron James is stat hunting. That was believed to be from Jay Crowder. He needed to get out of that locker room. They did that. So the added bonus is, they bring in the league's leader in three-point shooting in George Hill. They bring in an athletic guard in Rodney Hood, who's averaging 17 points per game this year. They bring in another athletic big in Larry Nance Jr., who we'll see if his daddy, Larry Nance Sr., will let him wear his retired number 22. The Cavs have retired his dad's number, might let his son wear it. And then as an added bonus, a backup point guard in Jordan Clarkson.
Who, by the way, all younger. All younger.
Oh, listen, 25, 25, 25, and 31 in George.
Jenna, you're going to be surprised. All of them can shoot except one.
Mm-hmm. So these are basketball players who can shoot the basketball?
Yes, but the Nance trade being part of the trade is a big deal, too, because now they have another defensive big. Mm-hmm. All right, with Kevin Love being out, Tristan not playing the defense, if they decide to go small, they can put Nance at the five, and they can still build a guard team, especially teams that go small like Golden State.
And Nance has been playing the style Tristan was playing to get his contract.
And what all kind of style was that?
All the little things, all effort, never worried about his own.
Don't have to call a play for him.
Of course not. Can go catch some hoops. Now he's more athletic than Tristan. He's a little shorter than Tristan. But a guy that we will see in the next 2 weeks, sometime on this show during our butt first segment when we typically show dunks, some crazy alley-oop from LeBron to Nance. So the team got two true knockdown shooters. One in Rodney Hood, one in George Hill. Some athleticism in Larry Nance, and I would say a good upside backup point guard in Jordan Clarkson. And they got the players they lost. Shump wasn't playing. Crowder, IT, and Rose were negatives. D-Wade will be missed, but they gave D-Wade the choice. You're going to have your minutes cut because we got these guys, or we can send you to Miami. And Channing wasn't playing well. Channing was good in the locker room. One of the reasons they then brought in Kendrick Perkins to fit that locker room role. This is, by all measures, a home run for the Cavs. And I don't know. Maybe they didn't want to give up that first-round pick. You'll deal with giving up your own first-round pick, especially because you still have the Brooklyn pick.
I think the Cleveland Cavaliers approached the trade deadline wanting to answer two questions. One, what could they do to win the East, or at least what could they do to win, and what could they do to keep LeBron James? I mean, those are the two key questions they needed answered. Do you guys feel like they answered both of those questions in some capacity?
They really did, because they took an honest look at themselves and realized that even though Nick wasn't afraid, they were not a good basketball team. And if you're not a good basketball team and you can't compete for championships, LeBron is definitely going to leave. He wouldn't have any other choice. Now you've made it very, very difficult because through Daniel Gilbert and the general manager, Kobe, you can see that they made the right move so they can be competitive and also that they could add LeBron to a max contract and still be competitive into the future.
And the other thing is that one added bonus they get from this, it's the biggest acquisition any team has made at the trade deadline in the last 5 years in the NBA, maybe longer. They got a reinvigorated LeBron James.
Yeah.
What they added to their team today is the best player in the world locked back in.
Re-engaged.
We saw what a re-engaged LeBron looked the day before the trade deadline. Now, the downside is this. You got four new players. They're all rotation players. You only have 30-some-odd games left. Kevin Love is only going to be able to play with these guys for a half dozen or so games before the playoffs. There should be some stops and starts. But they only play three times in the next 13 days, CC. A team that doesn't practice a lot is going to have the opportunity to get some practice, to have some guys come in there. And when the offense is essentially LeBron James runs the show, guys can fit into that if they can hit shots.
LeBron needs to fly them all out to the All-Star game because the All-Star break is extended now. have them do some practice, some walkthroughs and everything in Los Angeles, go take advantage of the time, get acclimated, make a run. After the
they can stay in one of his two $20 million homes in Los Angeles, the Brentwood one, or the Bel Air one, which one, not sure.
The Chris Carter mode of getting people together to train. Come out to me, I will train you, now you go back and then let's go win.
Yeah, we can enjoy the All-Star break, get ready, try to make a dash
for
the championship.
Nick and I doing suicides for like 8 straight hours before we started
this show.
All right, we're going to talk much more about this over the course of the next 3 hours. Billy King is going to stop by to give us his insight as well.
But coming up
is Jimmy.